here welcoming you all to this live webinar on behalf of SCAT College of Engineering and Technology, Department of Mechanical Engineering. I hope that all of you are safe and healthy. Our institution located at Seran Magadevi, Tirunelveli districts, it's an education wing of SCAT group of institutions. With good reputation under its name, our institution has gained 20 years of experience in shaping the career path of our students. Our real thrust is on multi-perspective development. Apart from regular curriculum, to bridge the gap between the industrial requirement and the academia, we are providing skill training to all the students right from first year. As a REAP, we reached a milestone of 90% good placements. With this short note about our institution, let me introduce today's webinar resource person, Dr. A. Megalingam. With the design as his field of specialization, he is having more than 15 years of professional experience. He completed his undergraduate in the Department of Mechanical Engineering in Dr. Srinidhi Adityanarayana College of Engineering. He had his postgraduation in engineering design at Government Engineering College, Tirunelveli. He completed his doctoral degree in tribology machine design at IIT Madras. He also published the 13 technical articles in international journals in his credit, 14 conference presentations in both national as well as the international level. He also applied 4 funded projects of total worth of rupees 50 lakhs. He is guiding 7 PhD scholars, and presently he is an associate professor, Department of Mechatronics in Bannariamman Institute of Technology, Coimbatore. My kind attention to the participants. First of all, our wishes and gratitude to all the participants. If you have any queries, please post it on chat box. All the questions will be answered at the end of the session. At the end of the session, the feedback link will be posted at the chat box. Thank you all. Once again, I welcome you all for the session. Now I invite Dr. A. Megalingam to this session. I welcome you, sir.
Two rough surfaces can be converted into an equivalent single rough surface, which is having of the hemispherical asperities. The asperities are considered of having the same radius of curvature, and that will be allowed to contact with a rigid flat plane. So what are the assumptions are supposed to be taken for the statistical single asperity contact model? So I will tell what is the meaning of the statistical distribution based one. I'll tell you. And first one, this rough surface is supposed to be taken as isotropic. That means I can say that in all the directions, I assume that the surface condition is same. And next one, all the asperities are having spherical near their summits, nothing but the near their contact places, and are having the same radius of curvature. And third one is all the asperities summits, nothing but the asperities are vary, their heights are vary in a random manner, or I can say that they may follow some Gaussian distribution. That is nothing but our normal distribution. Sometimes people used to consider as a Weibull distribution, and that's the thing we are calling as a statistical distribution. You know what is mu 3 sigma, 6 sigma concept, a statistical distribution, all are almost the same thing of the normal distribution curve. So here also we are assuming that the surface heights are having the normal distribution, statistical distribution. So that's why we are calling as a statistical single asperity contact model. Okay. So by knowing the single asperity behavior, we can extend for the whole surface. That surface heights are varying in a normal distribution pattern or Gaussian distribution pattern, or I can say the statistical distribution. And one more important thing in the assumption is there is no interaction between the asperities. There would not be any interaction between the adjacent asperities. That is another important assumption. And last one is the contacting asperities are deforming elastically only in their asperities level alone, they are not at all allowed to deform the bulk surface. I mean the substrate. It is not at all going to affect the substrate, and they are assumed to deform in an elastic manner. So the Hertz elastic equation, he has developed the first elastic based equation of conducting of two surfaces, or I can say the two elliptical bodies. Whenever two elliptical bodies are come into contact, how they are going to deform elastically, that is given by the Hertz, and people used to call as an elastic solution. And these are the assumptions are taken by the Greenwood and Williamson in 1966 before going to extend the single aspect model to a rough surface. Now, as I said earlier, if I know the behavior of a single asperity, then I can extend to the whole surface, because just the surface is having of height, different height distribution, or I can say the different heights with the normal distribution or Weibull distribution. So single asperity contact model evaluation is very necessary, and how this single asperity is going to deform in elastic and elastoplastic and plastic stage. If I know that behavior, if I know the behavior of a single asperity deformation, then I can extend for the whole surface. For that, what I have taken? I have taken from our statistical single asperity contact model, I will consider only a single asperity. That asperity is considered here. You know that it's an axis symmetric. So it's an axis symmetric about this vertical line. So I have taken a quarter of a circle. If I revolve about this vertical line, then I can get my hemispherical asperity. So I have used the ANSYS for modeling as well as for the analysis content. So I have shown a one, I have shown the axis symmetric model. So I have considered the 1/4 of a circle, and that axis symmetric. So it is meshed with 8 node solid element, that is plane 82. And the top single line is nothing but our flat plane. It's a flat plane. And this is our asperity. So if I revolve this one about the vertical axis, I will get my hemispherical asperity. So now the rigid flat plane, which is allowed to interfere with our asperity, whereas the bottom forces are constrained to move in all direction. Nothing but I have a fixed, given the fixed condition in the bottom, and the vertical portion line is I have given as an axis symmetric, and the flat plane, which is just touching the first nodal point of this asperity, and omega is called the interference. So it is now going to interfere with the asperity. Okay. And in order to define the interaction between the rigid plane and the asperity, I have defined the surface to surface contact pair. So if you define the surface to surface contact pair, then only these two models will try to interact with each other. If you didn't, if you fail to define the surface to surface contact pair, then these two bodies are taken as a rigid bodies, it will start to move independently. So we are supposed to define the surface to surface contact pair, surface to surface interaction. So in such a case, what will happen if you define the contact pair between these two components or these two portions, then the contact elements will be defined at the outer peripheral of this asperity, and the target element will be taken in the rigid flat line or plane or considered. Okay. So this is the ANSYS model. Then what about the material properties? Here I have taken the E by Y ratio of 79:952. Please understand, E is the Young's modulus, Y is the yield strength of the material. They used to write sigma Y. So just I have taken the Y. So E by Y is nothing but the Young's modulus to the yield strength ratio. So I have covered 79:952 range. So wide span of material properties are considered, and the Poisson's ratio of 0.25, 0.35 and 0.45 are considered. So I hope most of the ductile materials are covered within this span, and I have taken the von Mises yield criteria. That means I have considered as a ductile material, and this is the stress and strain relationship on a elastic perfectly plastic material behavior. So presently I have considered as a elastic perfectly plastic material behavior. So once it's reached the yield strength of the material, then it won't take more amount of load to deform. So that is the condition of the elastic perfectly material behavior. And these are the E by Y ratios I have taken, and the Poisson's ratio also 0.25, 0.35 and 0.55. I have considered most of, I have covered most of the materials, practical materials. Okay, now, so once the rigid plane started to interfere with the our axisymmetric model, so I am slowly increasing the interference. That's the omega is started to increase 0.001, then 0.01, like that. I am slowly increasing the interference. What will happen just below the surface? Just below the surface means just below this point, especially at this location, the material will start to yield. So people may think that the material will start to yield at the contact, exact contact point. No, the subsurface yielding is started at this location, just the subsurface, not at the surface level. The material will start to yield at the subsurface, and it will slowly propagate through the outer surface. So what I want to tell is, so initially the aspect is will be in elastic condition, and when you start to increase the interference at one particular interference, that is called the omega c, that is called the critical interference. At the critical interference, the material will reach its yield strength. You know what is the yield strength of the material? So if you take the Young's modulus and Poisson ratio and particular yield strength, the material will reach its yield strength at particular interference. So that interference is called as a critical interference for this Asperity model, and the corresponding contact load will be taken as PC. That's a critical contact load, and the particular moment you will be getting some contact radius with the flat plane. So that radius will be used to calculate the contact area also. So the C refers the critical point. What is the critical point means? At particular interference, the material will start to yield, or I can say that the subsurface location, the stress, one vis stress will reach the yield strength of the material. So that point is marked as an end of the elastic state. So the contact will be end. So from zero to at the particular point of omega c, the material or the asperities will behave as a elastic contact behavior. Okay. And this curve is shows the ratio between the E by Y ratio and the P mean by Y. What may be P mean means mean contact pressure. So how can we calculate the mean pressure means? The contact load divided by contact area will give you the mean contact pressure divided by the yield strength. So the earlier models are KE model, JE model, and I have presented my content as a present model. So the people, the early people, they thought that the mean contact pressure ratio will not vary with respect to the E by Y ratio as well as the Poisson ratio. They have taken a constant value. But what I have observed is, it's not a constant one. It is varying with respect to the E by Y value. So if it is a very high strength material, then it is taking up more amount of pressure ratio. As well as the Poisson ratios also having some impact on that one, especially of the low strength, especially of the high strength material. I can say this is a high strength material. For the low strength materials, the effect is negligible. I can say that for the low strength materials, the Poisson ratio effect is somewhat negligible, whereas in the high strength materials, the Poisson ratio having some effect on that one. So at the moment, the elastic contact is restricted, or up to this point, up to the omega c, the contact will be an elastic one, and it is not a constant value, or the mean contact pressure is not a constant one, as some people has told that it is 1.15, and some people they have told that it is 1.6, and some people near to 1.8, but obviously it is varying one. That's the thing I have observed. And with this, we will go to the second portion of this asperities deformation. So from omega, from zero to omega c, the asperities behavior will be of elastic one. So once you crosses the omega C value, then the asperities will be of elastic plastic. So if you start to increase the omega C, or I can say if you start to increase the omega beyond the omega C, then the deformed zone will start to propagate and it will touch the outer surface. At the moment, we are calling this contact as a elastic plastic contact. Why we are calling this one as elastic plastic contact means this is called the inner core. Can you understand? This is of inner core. Inner core, this is little bit of having green. You can see that somewhat. So this portion is still, or I can say that this portion is still in elastic content, or I can call this an elastic core. Whereas this portion, it is of plastic one. And away from this location also, it is of elastic. So it's a mixture of elastic and plastic. That's why we are calling this contact state as elastic plastic contact state. So the deformed zone will start to propagate. It will touch the outer surface. At the moment, we will call as elastic plastic contact zone. And this also observed for the various range of E/Y ratios, as well as at which location they are reaching the elastic plastic contact state. That's also observed. So how did you observe means, if you observe the omega by omega C from 0 to even up to 500, I have carried out. So I have taken off 5 to 15 span of the omega by omega C ratio, interference ratio. You know what is by omega C? Omega is the interference what we are applying continuously. And here I have taken the mean contact pressure ratio. So as if you start from 0, it is keep on increasing. At particular point, the pressure drops and then again it started to increase. So that drop portion that is observed for the Poisson ratio of 0.45 as well as the 0.25. So that drops indicates that the contact states moves from elastic to elastic plastic. So that's the thing I have marked for all other E/Y ratios and the respective Poisson ratio. Everything is plotted in this curve. And here you can see that for a high strength materials, here the Poisson ratio is reversed. In the earlier one, if you have noticed down, the Poisson ratio was in the upper portion, whereas the 0.2 was in the lower portion. Now the 0.45 has retained the lower portion and 0.25 is in the upper portion. So anyway, we are getting some variation, or I can say that the elastic plastic contact state is not at all achieved at a particular omega B omega C ratio, or are not attained in a particular interference ratio. It is a varying one and it is obviously affected by the Poisson's ratio also. That's the thing I have observed. Now, still we will start to increase the interference ratio. If you start to increase the interference ratio, what will happen? This small elastic core, we used to call as an elastic core, this small portion will also disappear. That you are going to see in the next slide. Yeah, can you see that? The small elastic core, which was existed in the earlier elastic plastic model, now it is disappeared. So how it appeared means you are slowly keep on increasing the interference ratio. At a particular interference ratio, the total elastic core will be disappear and the total zone will be of become as a plastic or fully plastic condition. So that we are calling as a fully plastic contact state of this asperities. And what is the corresponding interference ratio? Is it the same value for all the material or it is different? What is the effect of the Poisson ratio? That thing is also observed. So what I observed is for the high strength materials, the Poisson ratio effect is not that much. But for the low strength material, yes, the Poisson ratio having little bit effect on that one. Not little bit, it's having some enough amount of effect on that one. Because the interference ratio here is of 400, whether it is 500 here. So we can observe some larger deviation of attaining the fully plastic contact state for the low strength material. Whereas in the high strength materials, the deviation is little bit, not much. Okay. So what are things we have seen so far is, first one is the elastic behavior, then elastic plastic behavior, then fully plastic contact state of the asperities. So now I have observed the contact flow, that is P by PC with respect to the omega by omega C, how it varies for the throughout span of omega by omega C till 500. Omega by omega C till 500 I have taken. And what about the effect of the Poisson's ratio also I have observed. So you can see this curve. So a nonlinear trend is observed for very high strength materials. What it means, the high strength materials are achieved there or reached the fully plastic stage in a very early omega by omega C, whereas the low strength materials are keep on increasing or they are tried to provide a linear pattern. So that's the thing you can observe, as well as the Poisson ratio increases, the contact load decreases for all the EBY ratios, because the asperities will start to move from elastic, elastoplastic and fully plastic range. So that's the effect of the Poisson ratio. That's the thing I observed. So you can see the non-linear behavior of your high strength materials here. Okay. And what about the contact area? Is it the same behavior or a little bit different? Yeah, I observed some little bit different behavior. So for a linear behavior is observed only for the lower strength of materials, and the Poisson ratio if increases, the contact area started to increase. And if you go for the very high strength materials, if you go for the very high strength materials, little bit of non-linear observation was gathered or I can accumulated with the high strength materials. But one thing you can notice here, at very high indifference ratios, when the Poisson ratio increases, the materials becomes less compressible, especially in fully plastic region. So what I want to conclude at the moment is, with respect to the elastic perfectly plastic material, the contact load as well as the contact area not at all going to give a similar pattern of behavior, and the contact load is having of non-linear behavior, whereas the contact area, they are having of linear behavior for low strength material, whereas non-linear behavior for the high strength material. And in both the cases, the Poisson ratio is surely having some effect. And whether the asperities may be of in elastic condition, or it may be of elastic plastic, or it may be in fully plastic condition, the Poisson ratio is having some effect. Okay. So now I go observe the mean contact pressure ratio for all the materials, for all the Poisson ratio. What I observed is, when the Poisson ratio increases, the materials become less compressible. So the mean contact pressure increases for all the materials. So this is the thing I observed for the Poisson ratio case. And one more thing is, once the Poisson ratio reached the Poisson, sorry, when the mean contact pressure ratio, the vertical axis is the mean contact pressure ratio, whereas the x-axis is the omega by omega C, that is the indifferent ratio. Once the mean contact pressure ratio reaches its higher value, then they started to decrease. So that's the thing I observed for in all the cases. What it tries to give means, so whenever a material is indifferent with any indenter, or especially you can say that in the hardness finding method, the material will be indented with a hard material. So always we are trying to calculate the hardness of the material through indentation process. But actually what we are supposed to observe is material hardness. So if you see the hardness of the metals book by Tabor in 1951, what he has given is, the hardness of the material can be considered as the mean contact pressure, but it will having a ratio of 2.8 times of the yield strength. That's the relationship he has given. But it is not exactly matching with all the material properties as well as the Poisson ratios. So what we have observed is, the material hardness is varying with respect to the E by V ratio as well as the Poisson ratio. So for that, I have developed one equation for finding the hardness of the material. This is called the material hardness and not the indentation hardness. We are using is the indentation hardness, But obviously, we are supposed to look on only on the material corners. So material corners can be achieved by using of this relationship. So this relationship is a function of E by V ratio as well as the percentage ratio. So if you want to find the material harness of any material, you can utilize this relationship that is already published in the tribology transaction. And if you know the Young's modulus, yield strength and percent ratio, surely you can accurately calculate the harness of the material. So I have developed this equation by using the results what I have done with the ANSYS analysis. And this is the maximum mean contact pressure ratio, how it varies with respect to the E by V ratios as well as the Poisson's ratio also. But people are taking as 2.8. So far, people are taking as 2.8 times of the yield strength. That is considered as the harness of the material. But that's not a right one actually. Now, so far we have seen the material behavior is a linear, or I can say that elastic, perfectly plastic behavior. But is it true for our realistic materials? No. The realistic materials are having some strain hardening effect. It may be of kinematic strain hardening or isotropic strain hardening or both of them combinedly together in a realistic materials. So how can we go with the realistic material behavior? So that analysis can be extended further by considering the isotropic strain hardening effect for presently I have taken. So as I told earlier, the same Asperity model is taken, the vertical axis axisymmetric behavior will be taken as a fully constrained one, and the rigid plane or the single line is considered the rigid plane, interferes the asperity and the EBB percent ratio, especially on the contact loads. So you can see that the effect of the Poisson ratio is still existing. So the strain hardening rate doesn't alter the effect of the Poisson ratio. But if you look on this, the high strength materials, even though they are in the nonlinear behavior, especially at the very high interference ratios, their strain hardening rate greatly influences the Poisson ratio effect. So the Poisson ratio effect will be somewhat little bit altered by the strain hardening rate, especially at the high interference ratio, that is applicable for the high strength materials. Okay. So now we will see, what about the contact area, sir? Contact load we have seen. What about the contact area? So if you see the contact area, so in the x-axis I have considered the contact load, whereas the y-axis I have considered the contact area. Why I have taken such a plot means, for the same amount of contact load, yeah, what would be the bearing area of support that can be given by the low strength material as well as the high strength material, especially if you go for the some bearings. So in the bearings, we will be applying some load, what about the area support it can give for me? The bearings rough surface contact locations may deform elastically or elastoplastically or sometimes fully plastic in the presence of lubrications or in the absence of lubrication. But we want to know that even if they are dry condition, what would be the bearing load area of the bearings which can support for a particular load. So for that I have taken this plot. So for the same contact area ratios, if you increase the strain hardening rate, obviously the load carrying capacity also increases. That is truly, it is true for both the cases also, I can say that. And the effect of the Poisson ratio on the contact area ratio decreases when the strain hardening rate increases. That's the thing I have observed for the low strength materials. If you go for the high strength material, what is happening? The contact area behavior is of somewhat non-linear, and the strain hardening rate substantially increased. If you look at the, this is the zero case, or I can say the tangent modulus is zero. This is nothing but elastically perfectly plastic material. So what you are getting for the load, for a particular load, you can have a larger amount of area of support. So you can get a larger area of support only for a particular load, but you can't increase the load and you won't get any support on that point. So, but if you include the strain hardening rate in the particular low strength material, there is a possibility of taking up a larger amount of load with the considerable amount of bearing support. That is possible. So that's the thing I want to highlight here. And the effect of Poisson ratio also of notable one here. So here the Poisson ratio is not that much difference, whereas here you can see of lot of difference between the Poisson ratio. So the effect of the Poisson ratio on the contact area ratios increases when the stain cotton grade increases. That's the thing I want to note it down here. So what about the wind contact pressure? So here also it is trying to improve the ratios. I mean the mean contact pressure ratio is increasing for low strength material as well as for the high strength materials. First, if you consider the low strength material, when the strain cotton grade increases, the material hardness also increases as the interference increases. But what we used to do means we will be noting down only the first one. We will be noting down the first maximum mean contact ratio achieved by that material in the particular interference ratio is considered as the material hardness. So once it's having the effect of strain cotton grade, the consequent secondary plastic flow ranges are not taken as the hardness of the material. When it reaches the first maximum value of the contact pressure ratio, that is considered. Okay, and if you compare the low strength materials as well as the high strength materials, the strain cotton grade doesn't alter the effect of Poisson ratio on the mean contact pressure ratio for the low strength material. Whereas if you look on the high strength material, the Poisson ratio having little bit effect, especially on the high interference ratio, it is slightly affecting that one. Okay, this is the point I want to highlight the particular slide. So based on the previous results of the contact load and contact area and mean contact pressure ratios, empirical relationships are developed for the interference ratio of omega by omega c till one, it will be elastic behavior. So I can consider the Hertz elastic solution. Whereas if the omega by omega c is greater than one, so this analysis carried out till the portion of omega by omega c up to 500. So in such a case, how can I calculate the contact load for at a particular omega by omega c, for a particular E by Y ratio, for a particular Poisson ratio, I can calculate the contact load. So what we need is, we should know the omega c, Pc and Ac. They are the critical values. So if you know the critical values, then you can calculate the contact load ratios for a span of omega by omega c 1 to 500 for all the E by Y ratios. Okay. This is the contact area empirical relationship are developed. So all the things are developed for a single asperity. So once if you know the single asperity behavior, then only we can extend to the whole surface. So by using this empirical relationship, we can calculate what will be the contact load of a whole surface. That's the thing we are going to do now. So this plot I have put that, what would be the deviation with the experimental result and the present finite element result as well as the empirical relationship. That we are supposed to know, then only we can extend for the whole surface and our results will be validated. And by seeing itself, we can understand that it is almost equivalent, or I can say that they are very close to each other. So the empirical relationship as well as the finite element method results and the experiments are very close and they are in very good agreement, and the deviations are very less than 5%. So we can take our empirical relationship for the rough surface contacts. Yeah, now we are at the correct point of our statistical rough surface contact models. As I said earlier, if you know the single asperity behavior, then we can extend for the whole surface. Now, I have a surface. The surface heights can be measured through the 3D surface profilometer. 3D surface profilometer, we can have the machined surface. Any machined surface can be put it in the 3D surface profilometer and we can get the data points. We can get the data points of X, Y, Z. All the data points can be captured. So each and every locations, what is their height, what is their location, we can get it by go through the surface profilometer. Okay. So now I want to identify the peaks. Once if I identify the peaks, then I can convert into single aspect. How will you identify a peak? For example, one particular point is represented at Z I comma J. So please observe, this is the point of Z I J. For understanding purpose, I have given here. This is the point I have taken. I have shown a top view of this one. Please understand, I have given a top view. Now, in and around that, there are 8 points are there. In and around that, I can say that 8 points totally. 8 points are there. So, if this Z I comma J is the highest point compared to all other points in and around that, just in and around that, all other points are lower than the Z I comma J, then we can say that they are together considered as a single peak. That peak can be converted into an asperity. So what I have to do means I have to find the transverse direction, or I can say that for understanding people, longitudinal direction and the transverse direction, what is the radius of curvature. It is represented R perpendicular, or I can say that R parallel, R perpendicular. So these equations can be taken from the Hansel paper 1992, they have published. If you have a surface data, then how can you calculate the parallel radius and the perpendicular in two major and minor axis? For understanding purpose, I can say that major axis and minor axis. So you can calculate the radius of curvature in the major axis and radius of curvature in the minor axis. Or some people call as a parallel axis and the perpendicular axis. Some people call as a longitudinal and transverse. Okay. So if you calculate the radius of curvature in the parallel and perpendicular directions, then if you take the square root of both the things, then you will get the submeet radius, nothing but our asperity radius. So if you know the asperity radius of each and every peaks, how will you identify the peak? Means we have to compare each and every points, this data points, supposed to be compared with that neighboring points. If that particular Z I comma J is higher than the all other or adjacent 8 points, means together they can be considered as a asperity or submeet. If any one of the nearest point is higher than the Z I comma J, then we have to leave that point. That cannot be considered as an asperity. Okay. So like that, for a whole surface, even you may be having of 1 lakh surface points, then you got to write a MATLAB code and you can find what is the particular location of an each and every asperity's location, or I can call as a submeets. For each asperity, what is the radius of curvature? So I got to calculate the R perpendicular and R parallel, then together I can calculate the submeet radius or asperity radius for particular identified asperity. Like that, I can process the 1 lakh data and I can find the particular locations and the particular asperity's radius of curvature. Once it is found, means then you have to take the average radius of all the asperities. So that average radius is taken as our single asperity. So if we know the single asperity behavior, then we can observe the total rough surface contact behavior. That's the concept behind the statistical rough surface contact model. Okay. And that single asperity behavior is already developed. In the previous slides, we have developed some empirical relationship that is applicable for all the radius of curvature. That is independent of the radius of curvature. And everything is developed in terms of E by ratio, Poisson ratio. All the things are developed. So now come back to the our rough surface. Assume that the peaks are in hemispherical shape. Okay, hemispherical shape. And the radius of curvature is the same one, but their heights are following a normal distribution. Can you see that? The surface heights, the heights are from the mean plane of the asperities. This is called the mean plane of the asperities. This is called the mean plane of the surface. Okay, but what we are considering is the mean plane of the asperities. So only we have to consider the points which are all identified as a asperities one. So that particular central points are considered here, and that are the particular aspirative height points. We can calculate the mean plane of the aspirative height. So about the mean plane, we can get some statistical distribution, or I can say the Gaussian distribution. But most of the practical materials are non-Gaussian type. But with respect to some assumption, we can consider as a Gaussian distribution, especially of the short pinning operation. If you have done a short pinning operation of any component, that surface will be looking like as a Gaussian distribution surface only. So short pinned surfaces can be considered as a Gaussian distribution. So if I know the normal distribution of the surface guides, and I know the each and every asperities behavior, because the asperities are average radius, and now the rigid flat plane is allowed to interfere with the surface. The surface is considered as an asperities, and their heights are varying. So the asperities are now started to interfere with the flat plane, and each and every asperity will be interfering with the rigid plane at the different omegas. Can you understand? Here it is having of omega, but the omega cannot be same as here. And if you here, it is going to touch it. And if you start to increase the z value, the z is nothing but of the height from the top aspect to the mean plane, or I can say that small d. Can you observe the small d? This is the difference, or I can say the mean separation. I can call as a mean separation of the asperity, mean plane and the rigid plane. So when if you come to the surface, we have to take the parameter of small d. Small d is nothing but the difference between the flat plane and the mean asperity plane. So that is called the small d. And each and every asperity will be having a omega interference, and this omega will be different for each and every asperity. And these asperities will undergo elastic, are elastic plastic or fully plastic. So if you accumulate all the areas or all the contact load of an each and every aspirate, and we can get the total contact load or total contact area. Just we have to sum all the individual aspirates. One aspirate will be of deforming fully plastic, another one aspirate may deform elastic plastic, another one is just going to touch, or it just touched means it's in elastic case. So each and every aspect is contribution supposed to be sum. Some may be of elastic plastic, some may be of in fully plastic, some may be of in elastic. Think about the whole surface. There are lakhs and lakhs of aspects will be there. So all the individual aspects for particular D, for a particular D. If you increase the D, then again the aspects will undergo another level of deformation. So by stage, for each and every particular D, 0.1 times of D, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, like that, for each and every D separation, we can calculate the individual aspirate's contribution. If you sum all the things, then we can get the total contact load as well as the total contact area of the whole surface. So how can we carry out those things? Yeah. Please consider here, omega is the Z minus D. Omega equal to Z minus D. D is the mean separation of the planes, and Z is the height between the top aspirates to the plane. Okay. So this omega will tell about the what is the interference of each and every aspirates. And psi of Z is nothing but the aspirate distribution. It may be of Gaussian or it may be of non-Gaussian. And what is eta? Eta is the aspirate density. If you consider of 1 cm by 1 cm area, how much amount of aspirates are identified? Surely it will be different for each and every different manufacturing based surfaces. If you do of EDM process, the surface will have different aspirate density. If you doing of turning operation, it will be a patterned structure will be formed. In such a cases, the number of aspirates, or I can say that the aspirate density is different, and their distribution pattern may be of different. One may be of Gaussian, another one may be of non-Gaussian. And the aspirate radius, if you calculate the mean aspirate radius of your turned surface as well as the EDM processed surface, the mean aspirate radius will be different, and the aspirate density will be different, and the surface height distribution also may be Gaussian or non-Gaussian. So any surface can be represented by the asperity density and the mean asperity radius and their asperity distribution also. So the surfaces parameters can be calculated. So here I have given off three surfaces. I have considered of three surfaces. They are manufactured in different manufacturing processes. So sigma by R, sigma is known as the surface roughness, RMS of the surface, and R is the mean asperity radius, and beta, beta is nothing but eta sigma R. If you multiply all the things, you can get beta, and this is called the psi. What is mean by psi? That is called the plasticity index. Plasticity index. It can be calculated in a very simple manner. Just a square root of omega c by sigma. Psi is nothing but plasticity index, that is square root of omega c by sigma. So if it 0.5, what they are trying to mean out is it's an elastic behavior. So the surface will try to behave as are morely dominant by the elastic behavior aspect is. So what they are coming to tell is the aspect is will deform in elastic manner. When it reaches of psi equal to 1, then it may be of in elastic plastic. I mean, the most of the aspects are maybe in elastic plastic. And if the plasticity index is 2.5, then all the aspects or most of the aspects will undergo the plastic deformation. So once you know very well that once the material or the aspects are undergoing plastic deformation, then there will be, that is called the monod particles. It may be of adhesive process or abrasive process. Just if once the plastic deformation is occurred in any locations, then we won't get any load bearing support thereafter. So like that, we can classify the surfaces psi equal to 0.5, psi equal to 1, psi equal to 2.5. This is represented, or so far people are believing under this category only. And some people are, more number of researchers are working to figure out if it's exactly 0.5 or it is deviating from that one, or is it valid one, how it's behaving, all the things they are observing. Okay, these are the data of these surfaces what I have considered for the present one. And now come back, the total number of aspects in contact I got to find at a particular D. So what I can do, the total number of contact equal to eta. Eta is nothing but the aspect density. A in is the nominal area, that's the length and the breadth, what you used to take, area of any common, length and the breadth, the nominal area. So integrate over to the D to infinity. Phi of z is nothing but the Gaussian distribution of the aspect height. So this will tell you how many number of aspects for at a particular mean separation of D. Okay. Now, if I want the total contact load as well as the total contact area, so just I have to integrate. Eta will be taken as it is, An will be taken as it is, and P of Z minus D. What is Z minus D? That is omega. Interference. And phi of S is the DIZ. So I can calculate my total contact area, or sorry, total contact load from far away position to up to D. Up to D, what is the total contact load taken by the surface? Similarly, I can calculate for the contact area. So if you incorporate the our empirical relationship, you can develop some empirical relationship now. So that empirical relationship, if you include, so Z minus D will be varying of 1.5, and that is applicable only D equal to D to D plus omega C, and D plus omega to 30 omega C, this portion of Z minus D will be applicable. Like that, the empirical relationships are bring back to here to calculate the total contact area of the rough surface. So it can be applied with any rough surface. If you know these parameters, then we can calculate the total contact load as well as the total contact area also. So now I have taken the two extreme cases. One is the plasticity index of 0.5, another one is the plasticity index case of 2.5. First, we will consider what would be the contact area for the plasticity index case of 0.5. So if you see the plot, the x-axis is the dimensionless mean separation, everything is like again, it's a non-dimensional one. So this is applicable for all the things. Okay, I mean all the surfaces. I can say that. And I have observed the behavior of the materials for the low strength material as well as for the high strength material. And what is the effect of Poisson ratio? The effect of Poisson ratio on the contact area is insignificant when the plasticity index is of 0.5. That means if it is in the elastic behavior alone. So the people are observing that if it is that elastic behavior, then the plasticity, the Poisson ratio effect is insignificant. But if you consider the low strength materials are marking the higher bearing support compared to the high strength material, because most of the aspects are deformed in elastic plastic stage. But if you come back to the plasticity in this case of 2.5, here the effect of Poisson ratio is notable for a low strength material, but it's insignificant for the high strength material. So if you look onto the low strength material, what do you think means? For a low strength material, very high Poisson ratio case, the incompressibility phenomena of the Poisson ratio decreases. So automatically the elastic and fully plastic deformation of the aspects are happening. So a larger bearing area support can be achieved for the same interference. So if I want a very larger bearing area support for my bearing applications, then certainly I have to go for a low strength material, but the Poisson ratio should be of very high. This is the thing we can come with respect to the contact area. What about the contact load effect? Yeah, here we are going to see the contact load effect. So here also the Poisson ratio effect is insignificant for the particular yield strength. At the particular rebehavior ratios, the Poisson ratio is not that much difference. But one thing I can say that the high strength material shows have increased the contact load compared to the low strength. If you consider the rough surfaces or I can say that the plasticity index of 0.5, it means of elastic surface. And one more thing you can notice down, for a difference of 91% of yield strength difference, 91% of the yield strength difference, there are three order increased bearing load support is provided by the high strength material. So if you have a difference of 91% yield strength difference, then we can achieve three order higher load bearing support, especially it will be provided by the high strength material. Please come back to the plasticity index case of 2.5. Its behavior is almost similar to the contact area, what we have observed in the earlier slide. So the effect of Poisson ratio on the contact load is insignificant for the high strength material. But if you look on the low strength material, especially of low Poisson ratio case, we can have of increased contact load compared to the high Poisson ratio case. This is due to the lack of the incompressibility phenomena once it is started to yield. And one more thing I have to point out here is, if you have a 91% of difference of the yield strength, then you are getting of two order increased bearing load support that will be provided by the low strength material. But the earlier one is of 91% of the yield strength, you can get three order increased load bearing support for the high strength material. But here it is for the low strength material, the same difference of the yield strength, but you are getting of two order, that two only for low strength material, whereas this is for the high strength material. Only one thing you got to notice down is, this is one of plasticity index of 0.5 and this is the plasticity index of 2.5. So in conclusion, I can say that the rough surface contact behavior is affected by all the parameters. It cannot be given a single platform or a single equation can define the all the rough surfaces which are all generated by different manufacturing processes. So each and every processes will try to give off different level of support with respect to our application. So with respect to our application, we have to select the particular material and particular process, and we can calculate what would be the load bearing support, what would be the load carrying capacity of the particular surface. That can be predefined. So if I define my system, my mechanical design component system, even if for a micro devices, if I can define, yeah, this much of load supposed to be taken by these micro components, means I can define what is the process is supposed to be done and what is the material I have to select. All the things I can define in earlier manner, and this content can be extended to the manufacturing process parameters also can be included or can be incorporated. So if I take some feed, depth of cut, all the things can be directly incorporated to the contact zone and contact area with respect to particular process, then it will be much more useful for the researchers and the projects and so on. So, and one thing I want to highlight at the present moment is I didn't include the effect of the friction also. So the friction is a most critical one, and in general I can say that the coefficient of friction is controlled by 53 parameters. So if you take in each and every parameters, we are traveling in a ocean. So like that, if you include the frictional effect, then the study will be a larger one and it will take more time and you can do a lot of research on this place. And these are the some references I would consider, and thank you. Thank you, sir. Anything else? You want anything? Hello?
Thank you, Megalian sir, for your enlightening session on this micro contact behavior of rough surfaces. Really, the session is a thought-provoking one. Sir, we have few questions here. Shall I present it before you know?
Yes, sir. Please proceed.
Yeah. The first question is, what is the value of asperity density? Is it a constant value or it is a varying one?
Obviously, it is varying one, sir. Asperity density is varying one. I hope you can get it here. It's a varying one. It's varying.
Okay.
It's varying.
Okay. The second one is, what is the high value of sigma represents? What is the significance of a high value of sigma?
If you go for a very high value of sigma means the asperities are very peaked one. So the pitch will be undergoing the fully plastic deformation in a very quick manner. It's a very sharp one. High sigma means it's a sharp one, I can say that. When the sigma is very low, then we are getting a very smooth surface.
So thank you, sir. These are the two questions from participants.
Okay,
so
sir.
Now I cordially invite Mr. Bharat for a vote of thanks. Bharat sir, for a vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Now okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Dear participants, greetings to all. This is Mr. M. Bharat from Department of Mechanical Engineering. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks and this online webinar session. I, on behalf of the Department of Mechanical Engineering, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the participants who blessed us with their presence and took out valuable time. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to Dr. A. Meghalingam, Associate Professor, Department of Mechatronics, Bannerayappan Institute of Technology, Coimbatore, for his valuable presentation on micro contact behavior of rough surface. I also wish to express my gratitude to our management, General Manager Development, AGM, and Principal for providing us an opportunity to organize this webinar session with encouragement and support. I heartily congratulate to all the participants for their active participation in this live webinar session. As no program can become successful with a single person. So I extend my big thanks to our Department of Mechanical Engineering for their support and contribution. Bye-bye, meet you all on next webinar session by our Department of Mechanical Engineering Zoom. Participants, kind attention. Feedback form link is provided at the chat box. Kindly fill it out after submissions. You will all receive your e-certificate through your registered mail. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.